What gave you the idea of dedicating a documentary to this wonderful actress, Charlotte Rampling?
In fact, it was a gift given by the producer who came up with the idea of wanting to make a film about Charlotte, and then it was an offer that I couldn't resist, of course. And I thought it was a fantastic chance to get to know you and to learn more about how you work and your work and to get to know you as a person. So the whole project came to me like a gift, and I wanted to give something back as well and try to figure out a way of portrait that would maybe pay a little bit justice to your courage that you showed in your work.
Perhaps you can also tell us a little bit of how it is to be performing in a second language.
I think it's very fascinating, but it's very difficult. I mean, I'm now completely bilingual in French because I've lived in France for a long time and have made many films there. And then, as we said, I did the play there, so you can really study a language. But to actually play in another language in a film that you don't know very well is very difficult. Because I have done it in Italy. I've made many Italian pictures, but the time I made my Italian pictures, the films were dubbed, so we did them in each person. I mean, the Visconti film, there was Germans, there was French, there was English, there was Hungarians, there was many different languages, and everyone spoke their languages and it was dubbed afterwards. But now films obviously are being much more in direct sound. And the first time I did this was a film in Italy called La Chiave di Casa, The Keys to the House. And I thought that I would be able to do it quite well because I spoke a bit of Italian. I'd made many, many Italian films. I'd lived in Italy. But in fact, it was incredibly difficult because it's something about what actually comes out of you instantaneously, which is important in film acting. You have to actually be completely what you are at the moment that you're doing it in a film acting role. Otherwise, that split second that you're thinking, well, am I saying the right line? Is this actually the words I should be saying? That's going to be felt so that the spectator will actually not plunge into the depth of your performance in the way that they should be plunging. And that is a problem. But with French, I can do it. In English, I can do it. I'd love to be able to do it in German. I'd love to be able to do it. I have done it in Spanish, but again, it was very difficult. I mean, I can do it, but it's very difficult. It's not something I would actually wish to repeat too often because you are slightly outside yourself. So you don't have that intimate connection with what you're doing when you're actually having to think about, am I speaking? Is what I'm saying correct? I just have to know who I am and where I come from and what actually I relate to. And what I relate to most intimately is the fact that I'm English. I'm not British, I'm English. I'm not Scottish, I'm not Irish, I'm not Welsh, I'm English. I'm pure breed, full-blooded English girl. And I was brought up in England, my parents are English, and I've chosen to adopt other countries and other nationalities, especially through filming, because that's what I wanted to do. I wanted to be somewhere outside the boundaries of just the country that I live in. But I don't think anybody, and I think you'd all agree with me, we are what we are, born into, and what we are raised into. We are until we're nine. We what we have actually felt and experienced up until that age will absolutely be what we are for the rest of our lives. We can adopt other things and we can reach out and have other experiences, thank God, and learn to be tolerant and learn to accept all other possibilities that there are in the world to live with or to be amongst. But we are intimately who we are, so I am an English actress. I think it was stage work was something I hadn't done because I was in films very young. I started when I was 17 and I had quite a success very young, and I made films in different countries and it never seemed that I could stop or never seemed that I wanted to stop. I didn't actually really want to do theatre work. I was so fascinated by film work. And then at that time, at the end of the 90s, I thought that if I don't branch into what theatre could be and find out actually what the experience of theatre could be, then I would actually feel that I was really missing something. And it so happened that this play came up at a time when I was really thinking about maybe maybe I was investigating plays and thinking, should I now train myself, because it's a whole different training, obviously, that is needed, although I'd had a theatrical training, but it was a long time ago at the Royal Court Theatre when I was 19. And it was an extraordinary experience because it was about total exposure, really. We talk about exposure in our film with Angelina. It's the first chapter is exposure, about how do performers take on this extraordinary impact that is people looking at you, wanting you, and cameras looking at you, and being in the gaze and being in the look of other people all the time. And on stage, you are it's unrelenting because you're there all the time, and there's nothing you can do. When you come onto the stage and begin your play, you have to stay there till the end. You can't cut. You can't suddenly say, oh, I'm not really enjoying this take, can we start again? You have to go, obviously, right through. So this was a very profound and necessary training that I did with the French play. I then went to the National Theatre and did another play, a Marivaux play. Then I came back into France and I did a Strindberg play. So I did three plays on the trot. Really, it was like muscling myself up onto another level, really, if I can say.
As you can see yourself now, it's very interesting to listen to Charlotte. So actually, from every conversation that was shot, there's something in the film.
And they were all live. They were all one-offs, unprepared. Angelina prepared everything and made it with the chapters and with the way that it was structured and the concept. And within that concept, she decided on the chapters, because she asked me if I wanted to decide on the subjects, and I said I'd rather not. I'd rather she conceived it. So when she'd chosen a chapter, for instance, like Exposure, the first in the film, then it was like when you're talking about improvisation, that was obviously because it was a conversation piece, but it was a one-off always. Nothing was rehearsed, nothing, and what you have was the one take. I could have, on a second take, probably said completely different things.
Yeah, sometimes I try,
so
because...
You might have had a completely different version of one.
Yeah, because the sound was sometimes bad. You remember there was a construction site. Yeah. I asked you, please, can you answer it again? And you said, no.
So. Because that was the beauty of this particular format of filming, is that it if you think, am I performing? Is Charlotte Rampling performing Charlotte Rampling? I don't know. I don't think so. Because what I wanted to do in this film was to be able to just express what I felt as I was feeling it from maybe just one question or one conversation or one particular subject point, just to be able to springboard from there and not think about it. Because that's the way life happens. Life happens without actually us premeditating. The real things in life happen with no premeditation at all, the really good things. Of course they are, in a sense, prepared from experience, but you take that experience of your lifetime and from one moment when you're on the starting block, because my dad was an Olympic runner, so I know about starting blocks, the gun goes and you go. And that's what we do with all the subjects. Yeah.